Hello and welcome to today's video, which is something of a sequel to my first video, a surprising inequality in prime sieves. But this video can stand alone as well. Now, it's been brought to my attention that this sieve that's on the screen right now is actually called an Euler sieve. Turns out it's very hard to be original in maths, but this reminded me of another time that I was not actually original in maths, which is when, using this sieve, I derived this formula, which was actually discovered about 200 years ago by the French mathematician Legendre?
Legendre.
Okay. So although Legendre has been a bit annoying taking credit for my discoveries like that, I do think his formula and its derivation are very neat and deserve some attention. Hence this video. The Euler sieve is a variation on the classic sieve of Eratosthenes. You start with all the positive integers up to some number n, which in this case is 110. And we're going to remove all the composite numbers by removing multiples of 2, then multiples of 3, then multiples of 5, and multiples of 7. Now, because n is less than 11 squared, all the multiples of 11 that are below n are also multiples of 2, or 3, or 5, or 7. Generally, we only have to remove multiples of primes that are less than or equal to the square root of n. Then, we only have prime numbers, and the number 1, remaining. Also, notice that we've removed all the primes less than or equal to root n. If we use pi of x to denote the number of primes below x, we can say that our sieve leaves pi of n minus pi of root n plus 1 integers remaining. And this is on the left-hand side of Legendre's formula, so keep it in mind. But back to Euler's sieve. Everything I've described so far is characteristic of both Euler's sieve and the sieve of Eratosthenes generally. But Euler's sieve is special because it removes each composite number only once. Here's how it works. We start with all blue squares. Now we look at all the integers a below n on 2. It's clear that for all such a, 2a is less than or equal to n, and 2a is a multiple of 2. So we multiply each of these a by 2 and get rid of the results. That's the first iteration of the sieve. And it's going to be convenient to keep track of how many blue squares there are as we go. I'm going to have a discrete function, p, of I and b, give the number of blue squares below b after I iterations of the sieve. Now, onto the second iteration. We'll look at a below n on 3 this time, so that 3a is less than or equal to n. Now, we'll remove instances of 3a soon, but remember, we only want to remove each composite number once. That is, we only want to remove instances of 3a that are currently blue. We want to remove 3a only if 3a is not divisible by 2. We already know 3 isn't divisible by 2, so this implies that a isn't divisible by 2. And this is true if and only if a is coloured in blue already. So, multiplying only the blue a values by 3, we can now remove these values of 3a. And thus concludes the second iteration of the sieve. Using this function, we can say that the number of blue squares left after 2 iterations is the number left after 1 iteration minus the number of blue a values below n on 3. I'll send that up to the corner for later. And now let's do the third iteration. We look at a below n on 5. Now, when we remove instances of 5a, we want them to be from blue squares. This requires that 5a isn't divisible by 2, and 5a isn't divisible by 3. Now, 5 isn't divisible by 2 or 3. Generally, primes aren't going to be divisible by smaller primes. So these conditions are the same as saying a can't be divisible by 2 or 3, which is the same as saying a is blue. And this is a general kind of thing, right? Letting p subscript I be our ith prime. On the ith iteration, we look for a below n on pi, such that pi times a is below n. Then for all primes up to pi minus 1, pi times a can't be divisible by any of these primes. Pi is a prime number, so it's not divisible by any of these primes. So it remains that a isn't divisible by any of them. And this is true if and only if a is on a blue square. So there's this recursive element that comes through where the number of blue squares after the ith iteration is given by the number of blue squares from the previous iteration minus the number of blue squares that were below n on pi. So that's Euler's sieve. I'll see you in chapter 2 to derive Legendre's formula. So this recurrence property is the key to deriving Legendre's formula. I'll clear up some details. It only holds for I greater than or equal to 1. Otherwise the right-hand side would refer to negative iterations of the sieve. And now one very relevant question would be, what exactly is p of 0? Well, after 0 iterations of the sieve, all the squares are blue. So we need just the number of positive integers less than or equal to b, and this is given by flooring b. Now, one final thing to keep in mind. Recall that we only need to run the sieve for each prime below the square root of n, and this will leave pi of n minus pi of root n plus 1 blue squares remaining. So let's run through an example. In terms of n, how many blue squares are left after 3 iterations? Well, using this rule, we can decompose p of 3n like so, and we can split up p of 2n, and we can also split up negative p of 2n on p3, and we can split up each of these as well. And now, using this rule, p of 3n is equal to the sum of all these floored terms. And we can see that this looks a lot like Legendre's formula from before. And in particular, if we say the square root of n is between p3 and p4, p of 3n equals pi of n minus pi of root n plus 1. So that this is a case of Legendre's formula. Legendre's formula. So, looking back, how exactly did we get here? Well, looking at this tree diagram-esque thing, it's evident that we'll ultimately end up with the sum of a collection of floored fractions, with n as the numerator, a product of primes in the denominator, and a sign out the front. From term to term, only two of these things vary, the sign out the front and the primes in the denominator. Looking into the sign out the front, we begin with a positive, and every time a new prime is introduced into the denominator, the sign changes, as necessitated by this negative term. So, if there are an even number of primes in the denominator, the sign out the front ends up positive. If there are an odd number of primes, the sign is negative. So, that's sign taken care of. How about the denominators? Well, when only considering denominators, each column in this diagram involves a kind of choice. For example, in this column, there's an analog to the choice of whether or not p3 is included in the denominator. Then in this column, we choose whether p2 is included, and in this final column, we decide whether or not to include p1. So we can say, if we like, that there's a denominator corresponding to every subset of the set with p1, p2, and p3. And if we were conducting 4 iterations of the sieve, there'd just be the extra choice at the start of whether or not to include p4 in the denominator. In fact, we can generalize this and say that with m iterations of the sieve, each term will have a unique denominator corresponding to a subset of the collections of primes up to pm. Another way to look at all the possible subsets is to look first at the null set, then all the singles, doubles, triples, etc. This is how Legendre's formula expresses all the subsets of the set of primes up to root n, and the signs alternate each term in accordance with our even odd rule. So yeah, that's a derivation of Legendre's formula. I hope you guys enjoyed it. I should point out that this formula isn't, to my knowledge, a very practical way of computing pi of n, since the number of terms grows exponentially, being equal to 2 to the power of pi root n. But besides its apparent uselessness, I think the formula and the ideas behind it are quite pretty, and hopefully you guys do too. And I'll see you next time.